So that's our operating room. It's like a temple. This is the place where we operated today morning. Huge operating room. And these sceneries on both sides, so it's less claustrophobic. And that's our hospital, Mukhard Hospital, just about 1.5 kilometer from here, very close. And it's a tertiary care center. And I'll be talking about bariatric outcomes and comorbidity resolution. There's a team. You saw Dr. Amit Gupte, who will be taking a talk on endoscopy today. And we'll be showing the balloon tomorrow morning, standing next to me, and Amrit is on the other side. What is a bariatric outcome? Bariatric outcome is the phenomenal change that our patients experience. This lady from South Africa, after surgery, she looks like her own daughter. And that is the kind of transformation bariatric surgery does. And this is what we need to realize, that we have that power to help people. Typically, people ask, and most of the patients ask, how much weight they will lose and what will be the time frame. And it's very simple to prognosticate. First month, they lose 10% of their total weight. So if somebody is 200 kgs, he should lose 20 kgs in first month. If somebody is 100 kg, they should lose 10 kg in first month. And then about 5% every month for about 5 to 6 months, not 1 year, and then it gradually slows down. And overall, patients lose somewhere between 70 to 100% of excess weight. Lot of patients lose 100% or more also. From simple procedures like sleeve or Roux-en-Y gastric bypass, you don't need to do a duodenal switch or something more innovative. Now, what has happened now, you're doing bariatric surgeries for almost, I'm in it for last 20 years, I started 19 years back, but I was with Dr. Dhore Patil earlier. The approach has changed. We were only talking about weight loss initially. Then, from 2005 onwards, we started talking of treating diabetes, so we said metabolic surgery. Now we are talking of prevention of diabetes. There are diabetologists who send patients when they are pre-diabetic. Because they say by the time diabetes is diagnosed, 50% of pancreatic cells are already destroyed. So send this young boy for surgery now. And obviously he's also obese. So primarily to avoid a deterioration of pancreas. So a complete turnaround. And you have, I'm sure all of you have been part of bariatric movement. You know all these comorbidities. That is not the issue. Metabolic surgery, the 90% problem are the definitions of remission and resolution. Gradually, the definition of remission has become more and more stringent. But to the patient, this is what matters. Within first 2 or 3 days, almost 100% patients' insulin can be discontinued. Almost all of them, maybe 1 week at the most. Oral hypoglycemics in about 65% patients within first 3 months. But glycemic control is in more than 90% patients. So when I say 65%, they are unselected patients. Somebody who has diabetes for 25 years, somebody whose C-peptide is 1.2, not 3.4 or 7. So these are the total cohort of patients. And this is pretty good for those patients. But when you publish your data, you go by the definitions and you say, I have a remission rate of 65% or I have a remission rate of 35%. But that don't have a guilt about the procedure or about yourself, because this is what matters. Ultimately, patient looks at their benefit. Look at this publication. This was in 2013, Journal of American College of Surgeons. This is not about diabetes control. This is about reduction in complications, and everyone should have this presentation in your PPTs. Macrovascular complications, events reduced by 75%. Microvascular events reduced by 90%. Other vascular events, again, same way. Heart failure from 10.4% to 1.4%, and angina from 1.8% to almost 70% reduction. So this is because of long-term follow-up of these bariatric patients or metabolic patients, and seeing their outcomes and how the complication rates go down. It's very important to emphasize this to patients who are diabetic, that it's not a question of whether you can have one pill or not have one pill. It's a question of whether you will have less complications of diabetes in the long run. Obstructive sleep apnea, as most of us know, is very prevalent in these patients, and Amrit presented the stop bang criteria. All these patients require CPAP or BiPAP for rest of life, because once you have obstructive sleep apnea and are morbidly obese, you need that to maintain your lifestyle. But what kind of lifestyle is this when your spouse looks like a alien person with a mask on the face and every night with a machine by the bedside? So OSA after surgery is probably the earliest comorbidity to get resolved. Within 7 to 10 days, patients start sleeping better, their snoring goes down, and 93% of them have remission. That means they will never require CPAP again. And this is, and the CPAP machine can be donated within a month's time. Now, as far as PCOS is concerned, and these are from publications, the hormone normalizations happen within 3 to 4 months. Periods become regular in about 5 to 6 months. Initially, they may be regular because of the surgical stress. Otherwise, fertility improves. So there's a publication from Cleveland, I should have put a reference, Cleveland Clinic, where it says all those women who wanted to get pregnant got pregnant without medication, without clomiphene and other medication, spontaneously. And hirsutism gets completely normal in about 60% patients, not in others. Some women will continue to have hairy thing. But important thing is medication can be discontinued in almost 100% patients because they have regular periods. As far as cancers is concerned, there are so many cancers, now they count more. Most of the cancers which are related to changed hormonal thing are related to obesity also. And it's not a only question that more cancers will happen, it also happens that the diagnosis are delayed. Because if a woman has got a 1 centimeter mass in a large breast, it may be very difficult to palpate it early. While once she loses weight, or as a person with a normal size breast, this can be picked up early and can be treated early. So cancer is not only an issue, and this is a study, this is a SOS study, where they have these 2,000 patients after bariatric surgery, 2,000 complication conventional. They followed up for cancers in almost 100% patients for about 11 years. And look at what they found. That first time cancers in surgery group was much less than those in the control group. But this benefit applies only to women, not to men. Probably because they have more hormone related cancers, unlike men. So this is something that you can emphasize when you talk to a woman who is coming for a surgery, that your risk of cancer can go down. One of the things which is not mentioned in literature, and this is my personal experience, a large number of women especially say that they need to go to the toilet 6, 7, 10 times at night. And the only reason one can understand this is that they have a compressed urinary bladder. So with a capacity of 120 or 200 because of visceral fat. The moment they start losing weight, within 3 months, they sleep peacefully. They will probably use the toilet only once at night. So it's a major problem for so many of the women who are unable to walk because they have osteoarthritis, they have disturbed sleep, and they feel better. Post-bariatric, there is significant visceral fat reduction, bladder capacity probably expands. I have not done a study. Those people who are working in medical colleges can probably do this. And that reduces the frequency. This is again from the SOS study, 15-year follow-up, 30% reduction in first-time cardiovascular events, and 50% reduction in cardiovascular event-related deaths. Now, these are better than statins that are prescribed by physicians in terms of outcomes. So we talk about it. This meta-analysis of about 73 studies, 20,000 patients which were followed for 5 years, where their 2D echo was done before surgery and followed afterwards. And they found us, this is again from the Cleveland Clinic, improved structure and function of heart, and this concludes that it's a life-saving surgery, particularly for patients with high cardiovascular risk. This is what we need to emphasize, and I'll probably talk about it. Same thing applies for liver diseases. Non-alcoholic fatty liver disease.
10 minutes up.
Okay. 15 studies, and it improves fibrosis in about 65% patients. Forget the steatohepatitis and steatosis. It improves drastically. This young man came to me few years back, he was 184 kgs with ulcers in both the legs and a lot of lymph spreading every time that he will come for consultation. It was not healing for 3 to 4 years till he had a bariatric surgery. Within a month and a half, his ulcers healed spontaneously. So lymphedema is a major problem, and when patients come with swelling in the leg, I said, don't worry, within a month your swelling will disappear. It is just a lymph compression in the because of the visceral fat and the collection of lymph. This is our study. We have put a copy of this in your kit. Please read it later. So friends, just to conclude, bariatric surgery is a significant predictor of morbidity and mortality reduction. Now, as far as complications are concerned, we are going to have discussed tomorrow. But what we have been able to establish in last 15, 20 years, and we have gradually improved, that this surgery can be safely done as an inguinal hernia surgery. And how that is possible is by, as Dr. Amrit said, optimization of patient, preparation and optimization. Some of the patients we say, patient who walks in my consulting room is breathless. I say it will probably take 2 months for you to come to operation theater table. You have patients, I have plenty of patients. Till your arterial blood gas at room air stops improving. So you do a ABG, whatever is the saturation level, put them on nebulization, incentive spirometry, chest physiotherapy, repeat it after 2 weeks. If it is improving, keep on doing that till it stops improving. Whether it stops improving at 84 or 75 PO2, then you should operate with whatever risk is required. Higher the risk of bariatric surgery, higher the indication for bariatric surgery. That is my motto. Again, to conclude, our national conference is in February in Guwahati. I request all of you to join in, and thank you so much.
Question, please.
Yeah, Ajay.
Sir, with highly motivating talk, sir. This aspect of the benefits of bariatric surgery has not been highlighted in many forums. In fact, I was invited to talk on a similar subject. The topic was, can gastric bypass prevent cardiac bypass? So the surgeons, I mean the cardiologist and endocrinologist, are getting aware of this.
That's right. So you know, Dr. Mohan from Chennai. V. Mohan, he sends a lot of patients who are pre-diabetic for bariatric surgery, primarily for this reason. So I'm even taking his name because he's so aggressive about it and he has seen the benefits. And I think Praveen Raj is the one who benefits most because they were working together. But this is the way to go look ahead.
In fact, we also do a lot of cases referred by Dr. Anoop Mishra since I worked in him, in his hospital. We had an interesting case which we presented at the World Congress as well. And this actually objectively mentions how microvascular changes do take place after a bariatric procedure. This was a gentleman who was diabetic, and we did a Roux-en-Y gastric bypass 7-8 years back. Few years later, he got his son for a bariatric procedure, got his investigations done, found out he was in end-stage renal disease, IgA nephropathy. He was referred for a renal transplant. They did a matching for everyone, and they found the only one matching was his dad, who had undergone a Roux-en-Y gastric bypass. They did all investigations possible for his diabetic, what is his status, and all investigations were normal. He donated the kidney to his son, who had an acute rejection initially and then settled down very well. And when they did a biopsy, they found no telltale sign of diabetes or microvascular changes in that kidney, in the recipient kidney. And of course, the story goes on, and I operated the son as well, who was a kidney recipient. So those changes do take place and the improvement does take place.
But can I tell you a word of caution? So we had a patient, young patient, a couple, husband we operated, and 2 months later his BP was constantly normal, his physician stopped the antihypertensive, and about 2 months further down the line he had a hypertensive stroke and came to hospital. We recently did a follow-up of our patients 5 years down the line for publication, and we found a lot of patients, when you call up, they say, I'm off medicines for diabetes, I'm perfectly normal. And when you get their blood checked, you find their HbA1c is high. So let's not drop our guards. You know, we must tell the patient that these problems can happen and they must be followed up religiously. Bariatric surgery is not gallbladder or appendix surgery. Bariatric surgery needs a lot more commitment on your part, because patients are innocent, they're ignorant and innocent, they will not understand the reason why they need to follow up.
You need to know the kind of diabetes you're dealing with. It's very attractive to tell people that your diabetes will resolve or get controlled, but you need to really sit down with the endocrinologist. You need to figure out whether they have insulin resistance, quantitative, qualitative. You need to know the family history, duration of diabetes. Anyone with a diabetes more than 8 years, a family history of diabetes, more visceral obesity, those are poor responders. And you'll have to counsel them and also sort out the comorbidities. We found that actually, we did a research with gut hormones, we found this, that the diabetic resolution is independent of the preoperative BMI and the excess weight loss. So this is a different track. So our understanding of diabetes is evolving and obesity is also evolving. So be a little careful and I think work along in a multidisciplinary team. I think that's going to be the
Absolutely.
Key.
There. Can I just answer on that one? Actually, we do a DIRAM scoring for all our patients who walk in. And what he's suggesting is that if somebody is on insulin, HbA1c is more than 9, age group more than 40, diabetic duration longer, the remission rates are actually between 18 to 22%, and that's it. So that's what you need to tell the patient. Improvement, yes, almost 100% will have improvement. Remission, 18 to 22%. So that's the score. So you need to fit them into a score and then give an objective answer that this is what you would have as a remission.
Okay. Is somebody covering these scores, diagram scores and all? No.
We had this topic in Fords, Mumbai.
We are not covered it here. Yeah. So maybe all of you can plan it sometime in the afternoon or so. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, Dr.
Thank you.